On a cloudy day, when it's cold outside, I've got the money. Everybody say,
I guess you say,
what can make me feel this way? It's my girl.
It is Friday, November the 11th. And Keith, quite a week. Oh, you've disappeared. It's quite such a week. You almost disappeared. What was it, Keith? You're an old communist revolutionary. What was it Lenin said about some weeks a whole century happens? Sometimes nothing ever happens. This week was a major week, I think, in Silicon Valley history, although every week seems to be more major.
I think the last 2 weeks together you probably have to put them together as a single set of events.
Yeah, I mean, every day the headlines are astonishing. You have to blink and think, is this actually being made up? The FTX stuff is just, again, it seems inevitable. And then, but what exactly is happening? How did a guy like this get away with it for so long?
Well, the interesting thing is he wasn't doing anything that unusual in the space. So you'd think that he must have been doing something unusual. But what he was doing is, you know when you deposit money in your bank, what the bank does is it loans that money out, you know, many times over to other people.
But not to itself.
Well, it can... Do it through subsidiaries as well. It's allowed. But basically, leveraging a balance sheet is standard business practice. Most of the world is fake money built on top of actual money. And so what he was doing was, in a totally unregulated space, unlike a bank where there's rules about the ratios and everything, in crypto, there's no rules because the SEC has decided to mainly criminalize behavior as opposed to regulate it. So it hasn't really come to the table with a set of regulations and rules. So it's a bit of a wild west. And what this guy did is he had hundreds of entities, by the way, but two main ones. And he used his stable coin. There's a memory we have when the stable coin collapsed a few months ago. He used his stable coin, which was called FTT, as a currency to hedge against for various external investments, loans, and all kinds of stuff. And at an audit, it came out that there was between $8 and $50 billion of liabilities built into.
At what point? I mean, well, I don't understand. You talk about the legality of it. I mean, it's complicated, and neither you or I are lawyers. But at what point does it become a Ponzi scheme to take people's money and then reinvest that money to prop up the original business? Isn't that what Madoff did?
Well, actually, a Ponzi scheme is fake games. It's when you make fake games and you give some of someone else's money back to the original investor, pretending it's a game. And that's a Ponzi scheme. FTX wasn't a Ponzi scheme in that sense, in that literal sense. It was a leveraged banking scheme, which all banks do. The 2008 collapse happened because of that. So it is within the scope of normal
business. Just to clarify, what did FTX give in exchange for people giving it money?
No. The way it works is customers have accounts. Those accounts take the form of wallets. So you pay in dollars to buy Bitcoin or Ethereum or FTT, which is their dollar equivalent stablecoin. And FTX can't do anything with your Bitcoin or your Ethereum, really, because that's locked up in a wallet. So what it can do is build its own value in its own stable coin. which is what Binance does with BNB as well, and what USDC is.
So it was translating the value of your Bitcoin into another cryptocurrency.
Not just another cryptocurrency. So basically, it was taking in dollars. Its revenues were about $250 million, I think, last year. And it had assets of $1 to $2 billion or something like that. But it was leveraging that into multiple other businesses by investing money. For example, he invested $500 million in various VC funds through his investment vehicle. Now, the way a VC fund works is it draws money down over time. So he hasn't actually given them that money. Now he won't be able to.
All of mirrors. I mean, to what extent do you think Bankman-Fried, I mean, he's acknowledged his own guilt of sorts. How nervous should he be about ending up in jail?
We don't really know the answer to that because we don't know whether he did anything criminal or whether he just was had bad judgment. Obviously, it's equally the same for the victims, but at least up until now, this morning they filed, all the entities filed for Chapter 11 bankruptcy protection. The implication there is that there is not criminal behavior, but we don't know.
He went from, as you say in the newsletter, $32 billion of value to zero in less than 48 hours. Astonishing.
Yeah, and that's due to the stat collapse of the stablecoin. Probably there's some value in wallets that people who did business with FTX will be able to retrieve because they're the custodians of it. FTX are the custodians, but the owner is the wallet owner. So one assumes that some of that, I saw an interview this morning with Galaxy Digital saying that they were able to cash out of their positions. In FTX, so we'll see. But it screams out, and you know me, I'm normally anti-regulation, but in the case of crypto, I'm very pro-regulation, and I think the SEC is largely to blame.
You can't have it both ways. You can't criticize the SEC all the time. You criticize the SEC for wanting to have more regulation, and now you're criticizing them because they didn't have enough regulations. I mean,
well, crypto is a special case of zero regulation. I mean,
attempted. I mean, it's not as if they didn't want to have.
No, they haven't actually. Actually, the biggest critique of the SEC when it comes to crypto is they're reactive in terms of criminal cases and settlements. But there's no, they are claiming that the rules of securities covers crypto, but it doesn't actually. So the banks have rules. I think we all think that some rules are good, right? Banks have rules. Crypto banks don't.
Yeah. Well, this is certainly the end of one major chapter in the history of crypto. There's no way that crypto can come back as it was. It has to come back. If it ever is to come back, it has to come back, as you suggested, much more heavily regulated. What about the broader messages here, Keith? I mean, I don't want to get involved with FTX. You want to have a shower afterwards. you refer to some ideas from David Kirkpatrick and Larry Summers in the newsletter. What are observers saying? Is this a major moment? It is, according to Summers, isn't it?
I picked up on this thread because... I know you're going to the Techonomy conference this weekend. My wife's going as well.
Yeah, I'm speaking actually on this subject. So I'm going to be quoting you.
Yeah, so I decided...
So you better be good, Keith. Otherwise, you're going to let me down. I'm going to pretend I know what I'm talking about.
Well, so what's the... Why don't you set the scene for us? What is the big questions that are hanging over this?
Well, the question, David Kirkpatrick, who of course is one of the world's leading authorities on Facebook, written a magnificent book on Facebook, now a great Facebook critic and founder of Techonomy. He and I are doing a conversation about the future of the internet, not the first or the last time that's been discussed on Tuesday to wrap up the event. I think David thinks that this marks an end, and not just FTX. Actually, we talked about this before the FTX stuff broke, but Musk and the general collapse, even Amazon losing $1 trillion of value, which is the most credible of all the companies, that it reflects the end of a certain time in Silicon Valley where you took for granted that the digital economy was exceptional, that these companies were somehow existed outside the normal laws of gravity of economics, from Google to Facebook to Twitter. And I think David thinks that's changed. It doesn't mean they're all going to crash. Doesn't mean it's the end of the digital economy. But from now on, the normal rules of economics applies to digital economics as well and to Silicon Valley. Do you think there's some truth to that?
I do think there's truth to it, but I think you've got to contextualize it. Otherwise, what happens is you overreact and you misinterpret what's going to happen next. I think the context here is that money valued growth above everything else for the last 3 years. So growth was the main valuable asset, and people would pay a large multiple of revenue for growth. Why? Because they're pre-buying future size in a way. And
that was seductive when a lot of the growth was from already very large companies. So it wasn't even startups. It was the Googles and the Amazons and the Facebooks of the world.
Yeah, but a lot of money also went into companies like Snowflake and Datadog, Peloton for a time.
Stripe, Zoom. And then other companies kind of in between, like Stripe, that got huge amounts.
Stripe. There was the COVID era companies, which is really Zoom and Roku and people like that.
Peloton, which pets.com was the poster child for the dot-com crash. So Peloton seems to have become the poster child for this crash.
Right. So there was basically a 2 to 3 year window starting in 2020, I think, where growth was the main variable. And so, you know, the valuation of companies went up based on growth. What's happened now is that the variable has changed to gross profit and free cash flow. So basically, you've got to be making a core profit and have free cash flow to get the benefit of a higher stock price. So the multiples contract when that happens because it's a multiple of a different animal. And so valuations contract, and Amazon lost $1 trillion, but, you know, in some senses, as of yesterday, by the way, it's back above $1 trillion in value. Yeah. But in some senses, it didn't really lose $1 trillion. What happened is investors who believed that growth should be the main variable, who didn't sell, lost money. Amazon itself is still fine. And so I think what happens next is we go back to a period, especially after yesterday's inflation numbers showed it coming down. The stock market the last 2 days, some of the tech stocks are up more than 25% in 2 days. So what's happening now is basically there'll be a reversion back to the mean where growth is not irrelevant. But profits.
You're not answering David Kirkpatrick's question.
So in a way, I'm saying no. I'm saying he's wrong. I'm saying he's mistaking the end of an era for the end of a short-term period of exuberance.
But the markets are, and not just tech stocks are up 20-25%. Also, gas stocks and chemical stocks and transportation stocks. So I think his point is that these digital tech companies, they're no different from any other company, and they're capable of making large amounts of money, but they don't exist in a different kind of orbit.
Well, you're right that they're no different. However, the common currency you can measure them by, it has got to be something you can put in a spreadsheet. So I think the common currency ultimately ends up being a factor of growth, profit, and absolute size.
Well, there you have it, David Kirkpatrick, if you're watching, and I'm going to repeat what Keith said in part on Tuesday and pretend that I came up with it myself. What about Larry Summers, Keith? He's not going to be, I don't think, at Techonomy. What's Larry Summers been saying this week? Of course, the former boss of Sheryl Sandberg, who is a mistress of timing. She departed the Facebook stage at just the right moment.
Yeah. So Larry was interviewed by Jessica Lessing from The Information. And I should say, by the way, The Information has been fantastic.
Yeah, I agree. They are truly living up to their name. They are outstanding.
It's proper journalism.
You should buy them. Now TV or That Was The Week should buy The Information.
Yeah, we definitely should. I already buy it, but...
No, I mean, we should acquire them.
I understood.
Bring them into our empire.
So Larry Summers was interviewed, and actually I anticipated Larry Summers being a bit of a pessimist and a downer, but he is not a caricature Democrat when it comes to economics.
Democrats hate him. I mean, if you want to get especially a progressive Democrat angry, just bring up Larry Summers. He's probably more hated than Donald Trump.
So what he does is he talks about opportunity more than he talks about risk. Mm. And he focuses in on where he thinks the opportunity is. He is the one that really characterizes the last 3 years as being unusual. And he therefore does not overreact to the last 3 years.
Yeah.
He then says that there's going to be a new period of exuberance, but it's going to be focused on new tech. In particular, he talks about... biotechnology, a bunch of other stuff as well.
Well, he's not the first to talk about biotech, and I assume AI and
life sciences is his big theme. He thinks that life sciences will
That's not a new argument. And coming back to the question of regulation, those are much more regulated industries. I mean, I wonder how much of this is bound up in the question of regulation. And one of the reasons why digital has been so successful and yet so turbulent because of the absence of regulation manifested particularly with crypto. I mean, life sciences has to be, by definition, heavily regulated. So you're never going to have these churns, these absurd ups and downs, are you?
Well, you do get the Theranoses of this world.
But those are just criminal frauds. I mean, that's not going to do with the market. And I don't know if you covered it this week, but Ms. Theranos tried to get away from going to jail. Doesn't seem as if she has, which at least there's some justice left in the world.
Yeah, but I think I don't think regulation is the main variable. I think the main variable is money and opportunity, market size and speed. Money doesn't just care about growing, it cares about growing fast. So actually the absence of regulation is like a magnet for money. So it's very likely that the next stage of innovation and money is going to be in things like artificial intelligence and automation.
Yeah, well, we all know that one. I mean, that's given. I mean, that was even part of the digital economy. I mean, the big players now, Google and Amazon and Apple, they're all AI companies in different forms, aren't they?
They are. And the word AI is misused all over.
I mean, it's like talking about the internet. I mean, it's an out-of-date word. It's meaningless.
Yeah, you need to get to the next level of detail about what something actually is. That said, you know, it's a useful handle. I use it at SignalRank. I say we're an AI-driven investment platform. Now, are we? Well, we use data.
We talked about this beforehand, Keith. Are you incorporating this historical data into your algorithm? How would SignalRank make sense of the absurd, almost ahistorical turbulence of the last 3 years?
Well, like all good data sets, we are not limited to a single period of time. So our data goes back to the late 1990s, and we specifically zoom in to the 2012 through 22 period to understand trends. And we have windows, different windows. So we look at 3-year windows and 5-year windows. The last 3-year window.
You don't use windows for your data, do you?
No, we don't. We use the cloud. But so if you ask the question, how does your algorithm predict the best B rounds when we've gone through turbulent times? It basically is looking at investment trends you know, that exist in a context of a market, and it's looking for the top 1% in any given market. So if the market gets frothy, we look for the top 1%. And if the market is constrained like it is now, we look for the top 1%. And we're about 30% successful at finding the top 1%, which is very high, by the way.
I mean, what happens in a market where the top 1% aren't coming through? I mean, you're always going to have a top 1%.
There's always a top 1%, yeah.
But if what Kirkpatrick is saying is right, and the economics are simply, I wouldn't say deflationary, but more normal, then the top 1% doesn't really have any meaning anymore.
Well, it does, because it's relative performance of money. If you reduce it all down to a single currency, it's the relative performance of money. So if you're in the top 1%, your relative performance compared to the other 99% is going to be good. And what now, whether that is 3 times your money or 10 times your money, that's macro. That's macro. We can't affect that. But we can make sure that we target money at the top 1%. And in practice, what does that mean in practice? It means in practice, over a long period of time, about 30% of our companies that we choose become unicorns and do an average of 15 times return on the B round money. And that's pretty constant through all markets. So
Keith, you're ahead of the times, as you always are. It's all timing. What about, we have to mention Tesla and Musk. I mean, it's been another insane week. Most of the senior execs leaving, Musk threatening, maybe promising that Twitter will go away and just go bankrupt. We won't have to hear about it anymore. Is there anything exceptional this week on the Musk Twitter front?
Well, I see Musk as a really good canvas to discuss what's going on generally in society when it comes to civility and discussion. My observation is that Musk is a highly controversial character that attracts a lynch mob. And the lynch mob, interestingly enough, is mostly...
Be careful with that word, Keith. Lynch mob is...
Well, I mean it...
He's not actually being lynched.
No, I mean it allegorically. I don't mean it literally. But there's a big... mainly from the left, opposition camp that objects to a billionaire buying a company and making decisions.
And then laying off half the staff, which...
By the way, is totally rational. I mean...
Well, there is no reason to celebrate. No one likes seeing...
No one should celebrate, but, you know, Jack Dorsey apologized publicly for growing Twitter too fast.
These public apologies from multi-billionaires like Jack Dorsey are also... there's something distasteful about them, just as Sam Bankman-Fried tweeted that he fucked up. I mean, it's easy to apologize. It doesn't cost you anything.
Yeah. Funnily enough, as somebody who, as you said at the outset, was a revolutionary communist in his past, I don't object to billionaires at all. I think billionaires are a symptom of opportunity that goes to people who take risk. And I actually have no objection to someone being a billionaire. I do object if billionaires become fat and lazy and are no longer contributing to society.
The fat, yeah. But you could, do you have, if you're fat, are you by definition lazy, do you think?
I think there's a correlation. I don't think
there's Reid Hoffman's fat. He's not lazy.
Reid's taken off.
Some people are also lazy, so I'm not sure. There's going to be some fat people, Keith, we've lost in the audience. Fat people, come back. We need you. You're not necessarily lazy, but you might be.
But the Twitter thing is, the bankruptcy thing is more of a catalyst for work. I don't think he literally means it's going to go bankrupt, but he means that they have to be committed to a subscription economy for Twitter.
Right.
And he's going to drive that through. By the way, he also did a great tweet, which I didn't include, which said, we're going to make a lot of mistakes because we're going to try a lot of things, but we'll keep what works and we'll dump what doesn't.
Yeah, and I mean, there has to be some admiration for the fact that he's treating it like a startup. Although there was one piece, I can't remember where I read it, saying that he's going to kill the company because he's treating a mature company as a startup. And that in itself is a contradiction. This is a profoundly interesting experiment, Keith. I mean, you're a startup guy. You don't operate well in pre-existing corporate culture companies, which Twitter became. Can you actually essentially destroy a late stage corporate company like Twitter and make it into a startup again without actually destroying it?
Well, I think you can. You have to, what you do is you're probably going to lose revenue at the margin from people.
To put it mildly, I mean, you're the question is whether you can cut the fat, cost. All the fat without the bone, talking about fat people without the bone.
I think he can do that, and I think he can navigate it to a better place. I mean, you talk a lot about saving democracy. It feels to me as if Twitter could, under Musk's tutelage, help save democracy. That's part of his goal. People characterize him as right wing. I don't think he's right wing at all, actually. I think he's very left wing. I think he understands that fascism comes from a dissatisfied middle class. And, you know, the worst thing you can do to the middle class is ban their points of view, which is what happens in council.
Yeah. I mean, I don't think the future of Twitter has anything to do with democracy one way or the other. It can neither destroy nor make it. What about the opportunity? I mean, whatever one thinks about Twitter and Musk, it's clearly going to kind of disappear from the stage for a while as it reinvents itself. Is this an opportunity for Substack? You're a Substack bull, Keith. I've always been a bit ambivalent, but as I texted you this week, maybe you're right. Is this an opportunity? They seem to know what they're doing. Is this an opportunity for Substack to emerge as a kind of long-form Twitter for writers and thinkers and filmmakers?
Well, I don't think it's a replacement for Twitter, but I think it's a different complement, not as in padding on the back, but as in adjacency. I think it's adjacent to Twitter. They introduced this week mentions and cross posts.
Yeah.
I think mentions are great. Cross posts, they haven't quite figured out what they want to do there. It doesn't quite work. And then they also introduced the Substack badge for a seal of...
Yeah, and that was a kind of tongue-in-cheek thing, wasn't it? Because of Twitter, the controversy over the blue ticks on Twitter saying that you can actually earn it for real on Substack.
But what they're doing is they're creating a network effect on Substack. There was a critique a few months ago that there was no network effect on Substack.
Yeah, you criticized that. They're listening to you. Yeah, I have to admit that I've never been I enjoyed Twitter back in 2008. It was fun for a few months, but I've never been a big fan. Maybe Substack deserves a real shot in terms of all of us building our creative empires and building our brands. Maybe there's something there.
And then Hamish will become a billionaire. We're all criticizing for being rich, which is stupid.
Well, I don't do that. I mean, only idiots criticize people simply for being rich. That's absurd. I mean, Musk is, I'm not a Musk hater, but there is something annoying about him. And you acknowledge that. I mean, he's autistic and has about as many social skills as Mark Zuckerberg.
Yeah, but that's part of the package, right? You take everything, and I don't think you can dissect him, reduce him down to something you dislike, and then therefore dislike him.
Yeah, I have to say, I hope he fails at Twitter, not because I don't like him, because I don't like Twitter, but that's another question. What about Zoom? Some interesting, Zoom could also steal some of Twitter's thunder. What's the Zoom news this week?
Yeah, Zoom had its developer conference, and they announced a whole bunch of things. The first thing they announced is an email and calendar competitor to Microsoft and Google. I've always thought that Zoom's meetings, whenever you schedule a Zoom meeting, you have to manually put it in your calendar because they don't integrate very well. And they've now produced their own calendar. I actually think that's probably going to end up being a mistake, because I think we're also dependent on the calendar services we already use, that it's pretty hard to think we're going to switch to Zoom for our email and calendar. I doubt we're going to do that.
Well, Zoom needs to buy Restream. I mean, we're on Restream. Zoom is better audio, a video. It's more reliable platform. I hope somebody buys Restream and incorporates them into some more coherent ecosystem. Can't you arrange that, Keith?
I can't arrange that, Andrew, but I think I'd make a good amount of money if I could. So if
Restream... Why can't you broker it? Just, you're a visionary.
I think Restream needs to call me and ask for my help. Then
well, whoever's running Restream, call Keith and get him in the room with the Zoom people and the Substack people, and then we'll have an interesting empire.
We would.
Is there any... We haven't covered your favorite, Keith, Tiger Global. We used to hear about how they're the future. They fucked up as well, like Sam, whatever his name is.
Well, not like Sam, but but theirs is
Sam, yeah, I think Sam will, on his grave, there'll be on his tombstone, I fucked up.
Yeah. So basically, they've marked down the valuation of the investments they made in the last 3 years. Big surprise, right? We talked about that earlier. So they're just doing what you have to do. They're telling the truth about what their investments are worth. And, 10 years from now, they'll probably be fine. But for now, they look like they made some bad choices, which they probably did.
Well, why aren't they? I mean, you used to talk about them all the time. They're hoovering up everyone. They're the future. What? How did they screw up?
Well, no, they haven't screwed up. I mean, they're still huge. The reason we talked about them is very specific.
Not we, you, not me.
Well, the reason I talked about them is very specific, and it's still valid, which is that they are a large pool of capital investing increasingly earlier in the life of startups.
Right.
And therefore disrupting venture capital, which
they're going still... downriver. So they're sort of eating the lunch of accelerators and early stage people.
Yeah, and they're still doing that. Kotu is still doing that. Insight is still doing that. So venture, the structure, in fact, this correction may accelerate the reshaping of venture capital as opposed to slow it down, because the only good funds are going to get money now.
So who's really been, I mean, you're Mr. Investment, Mr. VC now. Who has really been hurt and isn't coming back out of this crash? You seem to think everyone's coming back. Surely there are some permanent casualties here who will just die in your investment community.
Yeah, I think anything that requires increasing amounts of capital to get profitable. I'd be worried about anything that involves manufacturing. Anything that involves...
No, that wasn't my question. On the investment side.
On the investment side. Well, I'd say a lot of follower funds that don't really lead risk, but...
Can we have some names, Keith, of follower funds?
I would hesitate to name names because I don't have enough information. It would be intuition.
You know everything. You're just not going to publicly acknowledge follower funds. We know who the follower funds are. What about the bigger players, the Sequoias and so on? Sequoias. They marked down their FTX thing. Are they going to survive?
They're fine. Sequoia had a big gathering this week in San Francisco, many for journalists, and it was revealed there that the fund that lost the money has already returned a gain of over $1 billion. So they've lost 20% of their gain. So they're not underwater.
Some things never change. And two of the things that never change in our show is we always have a startup of the week and a tweet of the week.
We do indeed.
The startup of the week is a little one. We've never heard of this one, Keith.
The internet. And that's because the internet, even though,
you invented the internet, didn't you, Keith?
No, that was we all know Al Gore did that. But
but you gave him the idea, I heard.
Interesting. That said, I did start EasyNet in Europe in 1994 with my co-founders. And 1994 is almost 30 years ago, not quite. And the internet still, when you think about it, is in its infancy. FinTech only impacts 1% of financial services today. And we all know it's going to be 100% eventually. So we're in the early days.
We used to say that about digital music until vinyl came along. We used to say that about movies. I don't believe it will ever be 100%, but that's another question. But anyway, so why is the internet the startup of the week? Because it's not...
Actually, you're to blame, because you led me to believe that David Kirkpatrick and Larry Summers were in agreement that we this was the end of the internet. And when I read them, I realized that isn't what they're saying. But by then, I'd already chosen the internet as my startup of the week, and I stuck with it because I think we should remind ourselves that this is a little bit like the Ford Popular in the first year of the motor car. You know, everyone could have thought the motor industry was finished when Ford became the dominant car supplier back in, when was it, the 1930s or something. The internet's kind of like at the Ford Popular stage. There's a lot still to come, and we shouldn't forget that. And there'll be a lot of frothy exuberance in the future as well, just like there has been in the past.
That's an appropriate euphemism for insanity, frothy euphoria. But you may be right. So that's the startup of the week. And then what's the tweet of the week?
Well, it had to be by the way, did you like my title, Bankman Fried? I thought it shocks me that no one else realized that his name is Bankman Fried.
He could have been a fictional. It's sort of like a fictional invention. Does he even exist?
He does exist. And he's
have
a
you met him?
He's a local lad here, by the way. I don't think I've met. I might have done. It's a small world here. Anyway, it's his I'm sorry I fucked up tweet. It has to be the tweet of the week. By the way, it's very long. It's like the first chapter of a book. This is a super young, inexperienced person given quite a lot of money and turning it into $32 billion very, very fast. It does strange things to people when that happens.
Is this a young Keith Tier from 1994?
You know, I never really went through that, but my wife did. When we started Siberia Cafe in 1994, which was for those who don't know, it was the very first internet cafe in the world. It became a cause célèbre, and we had TV crews from all over the world several times a day for most of a year. Jenny and her co-founder Ava were on the cover of Vogue magazine.
Yeah, I mean, but she never.
No, they do go a little bit crazy because suddenly you believe a lot of the BS that other people say about you. And I think he became bigger than his capability and started making irrational decisions. And if you read his mea culpa, is trying to understand what happened.
I think to me, the really interesting question is whether they're, and we got to end now, but whether they're, and we've talked about this before, whether there really is a business in crypto. To me, I'm still not convinced, but that's a question perhaps for another week. There'll be more crypto eruptions and collapses and catastrophes, no doubt. Have a great week, Keith. I'm off to Techonomy. You're not coming. Janae's going to be there.
She is. Yeah, Janae is.
We can't tempt you up to Sonoma for a lovely weekend. Anyway, we can report back on that and many other things next week. Have a great week, Keith, and we'll talk next week.
Will do.
When it's cold outside.